The following presentation was recorded at the 2016 SouthEast LinuxFest in Charlotte, North Carolina. It is licensed under a Creative Commons license. For more information about the SouthEast LinuxFest, please visit www.southeastlinuxfest.org. The SouthEast LinuxFest would like to thank the following diamond sponsors in 2016 for helping make these videos possible.
All right, everybody, it looks like it's time for us to get started. My name is Thomas Cameron. I'm a global cloud strategy evangelist at Red Hat. Been with the company for about 10 years now, and definitely want to thank you very much for being here. I know that it's a work day, so a lot of y'all took off from work. I do appreciate you being here very much, both on behalf of me and Red Hat, and also, of course, SouthEast LinuxFest. So, I'm a cloud evangelist with Red Hat, and I am a technical resource at Red Hat. I'm a Red Hat certified architect, Red Hat certified data center specialist, Red Hat certified security specialist. And there's a bunch of other alphabet soup stuff after my name. I started out back in the day as a Nobel certified network engineer, so I'm dating myself there. And then worked for Microsoft for a short while and was Microsoft certified systems engineer, Microsoft certified trainer. So I've been doing this for a long, long time. I do not claim to know everything. In fact, the longer that I work at Red Hat, the more I realize, the less I know. What we're going to be talking about today is a little bit about container security. We got 1 hour together, so I'm not going to be able to dive terribly deeply in 1 hour. But I want to talk about some of the concepts around container security, the way that we secure containers, and talk a little bit about what containers are and what containers aren't. So we'll talk about who am I and why you should care, Red Hat and containers, what Red Hat, my company, my employer does, how they work, a little bit about what makes up container security, what are they, and at the end I'll talk about some myth busting. So we'll talk about control groups, we'll talk about the Docker daemon itself, Linux kernel capabilities, SE Linux, my personal favorite topic, tips and tricks, and then some conclusions. So, who am I and why you should care? Like I said, I've actually changed roles, so that slide's long. I'm no longer the Global Solutions Architect Leader. I'm now in the Cloud Evangelism Group. I've been doing this since 93, so been here for a while. I actually come from a law enforcement background. I was a police officer and changed careers into IT. So I have kind of a special love for all things security. Definitely going to Geeks with Guns tonight. I hope other folks are going to go as well. I'm looking for some range time. It's going to be fun. Been with Red Hat since 2005, like I talked about. I've got a background in IT, and I have been really fortunate in that I've been able to spend a lot of time working on IT security with customers ranging from financial services to retail to manufacturing, e-commerce, and so on. And like I said, I don't know everything, but I certainly have some impressive scars. So really, that's me when I'm not all made up and dressed up for being in front of customers. Big old geek. I love working on the tech, and so I feel like I'm really blessed to be able to do what I do. So I am absolutely going to be talking to you about our perspective, my perspective as a Red Hat employee about containers, but this is information that's global, whether you're using Docker from Docker's website, if you're using Source, if you're using it on Red Hat Enterprise Linux, on CentOS, on Fedora, whatever, these are concepts which are universal. So we've been working on containers since before 2010. We were doing containerization before containerization was really a mainstream thing. We acquired a company called Makara back in 2010 that was a PaaS offering, a platform as a service offering. That has been rebranded and frankly rewritten completely from the ground up as OpenShift, which is both a community. You can download the OpenShift origin stuff and run PaaS, you know, for free using community technology, or you can buy commercial support through Red Hat. We used originally what we called cartridges, and those cartridges used SE Linux, Linux control groups, and kernel namespaces to isolate processes and give us some really, really impressive density, and I'll talk more about that in a little while. Now, Docker really started coming to prominence in 2013-ish. That's when they really started to make splash. Gained community adoption, and we started participating in 2013. We live by the same rules we expect everyone else in the community to live by. It is a meritocracy, and we saw that Docker was gaining speed, and so we decided this makes sense for us to become as good stewards of the code as we possibly can. And to that end, we're a top contributor to the Docker upstream stuff. So last time I checked, and it's been several weeks ago, we're the number two contributor upstream. And that's not a, I'm going to thump my chest and talk about how awesome Red Hat is. That is, Red Hat recognizes that we are beholden to the greater community, and we do our best to be good stewards of code and to contribute as much upstream as we can. Everything that we do in upstream communities. So all the innovation that we do, all the bug fixes, all the documentation, all the stuff, we make sure that's available to upstream as well. So Docker's kicking ass. I mean, there's no other way to put it. Doing really, really well. There's a lot of companies which have thrown in behind them. They've gone through multiple successful venture capital rounds. You know, Apsara, Cisco, EMC, Fujitsu, Goldman Sachs, Huawei, IBM, us, Pivotal, VMware, all are on board with container standardization using Docker format as a standard. Even Microsoft announced that they were going to support Docker containers on Windows. So, we talk a lot about containerization, and containers are all the new buzz and all the cool hype and all that kind of. What the heck are containers? What do we mean when we're talking about containers? So, containerization, in this presentation, I'm going to be talking about Docker primarily. There are other types of containerization out there. You know, we talked about them before, and there's a lot of other technology out there. This seems to be the one which has percolated to the top of the heap. This is the one that we're going to be talking about. Technology which allows applications, whether it's web apps, databases, application servers that are not web, etc., to be run abstracted from and in some isolation from the underlying operating system. So the Docker service can launch containers regardless of what the underlying Linux distro is, right? Now, I work with RPM-based distros because that's what I've been doing for the last decade. But, you know, it doesn't matter whether you're using Debian-based, whether you're using RPM-based, doesn't really matter. You can run Docker containers, and the cool thing about it is you can take Docker containers that were built over here on a, you know, Debian-based system, you can run them on an RPM-based system, doesn't matter. They can enable incredible application density since you don't have the overhead of a full OS inside of the container. And that's really, really cool. We get some ridiculous application density on our public containerization offering, OpenShift Online. You know, to give you an idea, we're talking 3,000 applications per M1, or per, not M1, Jamie, do you remember the size of the instances on OpenShift Online?
M3s,
thank you. But we're talking 3,000 applications per VM instance on Amazon. Think about that for a second. That's the kind of density that I definitely want to go and talk to my CIO and go, yeah, I got 3,000 apps running per container. Because think about where we've come from, right? It used to be you wanted an application, you racked and stacked a machine. And then we got really efficient and we said, oh, you want an application? You spin up a VM. But there's all the associated overhead that comes with this. And now we're talking about you have a VM that can run 3,000 applications. That's pretty impressive. You got a question?
Well, I can put 5,000 on, but that doesn't make the customers happy.
We've generally gotten really good feedback with OpenShift Online. The responsiveness is very, very good. So, now, to be fair, that's not 3,000 applications all running at exactly the same instance. We've got a lot of mechanisms in place to put things to sleep when they're not being used, but I'm just saying, the ability to have things come up within about 150-ish milliseconds when a request is made, and have 3,000 of those things running on a single VM is pretty impressive. And like I said, the same container can run on different versions of Linux. You can get Ubuntu containers on Fedora, CentOS containers on RHEL, human sacrifice, dogs and cats living together, mass hysteria. Maybe not. Containers make it really easy for application developers to build and deploy apps. That's kind of the bottom line. So what are containers not? Well, containers are not a panacea. We're seeing a lot of folks are saying, oh, containers are good for everything! That's not true yet. We're getting there, but don't buy the snake oil, okay? There are still some cases where you have third-party ISVs who don't support their software running in containers, you have really big, complex, or really large, awful, ugly, horribly architected, horrible, applications that don't lend themselves to running inside. And there, it's not a panacea. It's not the cure to all that ails you. And they are not a fit for every application. I will caveat that by saying yes. Because again, a lot of ISVs are working with this technology, realizing, holy cow, all of the work we're having to do on, you know, installers and crazy guesses based on how much memory and swap and blah, 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 a lot of that stuff goes away. So there are ISVs who are working towards containerization. And they are not virtualization. I hear people comparing containers to VMware or containers to KVM, different places in the stack. Okay? Certainly, you can run containers in VMs. In fact, that's kind of what we recommend that you do because it makes a whole lot of sense. But I run containerization on my laptop. It's a physical machine. I'm not spinning up VMs to run containers. I run it directly on bare metal. So not quite the same thing. So let's talk a little bit about what the meat of this talk is. Let's talk about container security. The things which make up container security, there's a bunch of them. And we'll talk about each one of them. Linux kernel namespaces, Linux control groups or C groups, you'll hear me talking about C groups, the Docker daemon itself, the capabilities and the filtering of those capabilities at the Linux kernel, libcap, and Linux security mechanisms like AppArmor or SE Linux. I know more about SE Linux, so I'm going to talk about SE Linux. But there are other things that are out there. There's GRSec and there's AppArmor and there's all kinds of, you know, Bill and Ted's Excellent Security Suite stuff out there. So let's talk about what some of these things are. When I first started dealing with containerization, you know, I understood the theory of kernel namespaces. Like, I got it, you know, I'd read the stuff and I'd gone through the classes but somebody's like, so what exactly does it mean when you have, you know, kernel namespaces? And I was like, well, they're spaces and names and things do stuff inside of them. And I realized, you know, I don't know of a whole lot of really good examples of what a namespace actually means, what it really does. So I tried to do a couple of examples of what a Linux namespace, a kernel namespace, looks like in the real world. So the namespaces that Docker uses today include mount namespaces, pid namespaces, UTS, IPC, network namespaces, and user namespaces. And I'll show you examples of those where I can, okay? So a mount namespace, pretty cool tech. Mount namespaces just mean that the container thinks that the directory that it sees is exclusively that container's. I have a directory here that's mine and no one else has it. Well, that directory is actually from the host OS, and it gets mounted inside of the container, and it gets abstracted through mount namespaces. And you can do some cool things like you can run the -v host path colon container path, and then do things like, say, the container can't access this read-only or read-write. So you can do some really cool things, like put a common body of information, whether that's web content or whatever. You can make that one directory on the host available to all of your containers, and they can't modify it, and each one of them thinks, this is my stuff. So it's a really cool way of doing things like having multiple containers use the host's var www.html directory, for instance. That's a really common use space, although it doesn't necessarily have to be var www, it can be any web content, and you make those available to the containers, and they think, oh, it's mine. This is totally mine. So what I've done is I've done an example where you can see that I'm on the host, I'm root at t540p, which is my old laptop, and I cat var www.html index.html, and it says, this is my silly web page. Then I run docker run -v var www.html, and I'm going to mount it on var www.html, and the container that I'm running is the Fedora container, and the command that I'm running inside of the container is bash. So basically, you see that my prompt changes, so it goes from, instead of having my host name, it says bash 43, and now when I cat var www.html index.html, I see the same thing that was on the host, but this container thinks that that's a native directory inside of the container, it's not part of anything else, and that could just as easily have been an Ubuntu container, a CentOS container, a RHEL container, or whatever. So the cool thing is, it just abstracts that connection to the directory. And, you know, I mean, if you think about how that affects security, right, the fantastic thing about it is, you can have content that can be accessible from 1,000 containers, and somebody does something bad, somebody compromises a container, something like that, they're not going to be able to affect what's on the underlying host because of the way that you've done the mount. You know, it could be read-only or whatever.
What about your roots? Can they chroot out of it, or, you know, that kind of stuff?
Can they chroot out of it? Not really. Well, okay, I'm not going to say no, because anytime you say never, somebody's going to go, well, there's exploit, CVE, blah, blah, blah. But think about what a chroot does, right? A chroot changes to the root and represents the root of a directory. Well, if you're inside of a container, so let's say you chroot to part of the HTML, you're still seeing content that has been segregated from the host OS. So, can I think of a way to use chroot to do bad things? No. Not as creative as some of the bad guys out there, though. So. All right, PID namespaces. PID namespaces, very similar. They let the container think that it's a completely new instance of the operating system. So when you start a container, you're going to get a new process ID. Namespaces allow the container to see the PIDs inside the container as unique as if they were its own instance of an OS. So in the example that I'm about to show you, I'll launch a Fedora container and I run PSAX. Show me everything that's running in my OS. Now, what happens is, I run PSAX, and PID 1 is bash. Nudge, nudge, wink, wink, say no more. Yeah. So the container, though, is like, yeah, sure, I'm done fat and happy, or I'm done thin and happy, because it's a container. And I think that this is everything. Whereas, if I run a PSAX on the host, you can see the Docker container, right there. So you can see that PID is actually, you know, an 18,000 something or other PID number, right? So that's what PID namespaces does. It hands off processes to the container and goes, you got it, you're your own special little snowflake, you're all by yourself and you own everything in here. And that's cool, because that isolates it. But I love this also because this shows that Docker containers, or containers in general, just processes running on the host. All right, so I'm going to move on because we're a little time constrained. So user namespaces, similar concept, except that instead of abstracting process IDs or mount points, we're abstracting users. Now, when you start a container, assuming you've added your user to the Docker group, you can start it as your user account using upstream Docker. We don't allow that in RHEL because we do transitions and some things like that. But in this example, I start the container as user T Cameron, but then you'll notice that, so up here, when I do ID, it says that I'm UID 1000 T Cameron, then I run docker run dash IT Fedora bash, and when I run ID inside of there, I'm root inside of that container. So user namespaces allows us to abstract that out and let you do whatever you want to inside of your little sandbox. We will give you the gun, we will show you where your foot is. What you do from there, totally up to you. But what you do in there isn't going to affect the host. So that's what user namespaces allow for. So network namespaces allow a container to have its own IP address independent of the host. Those addresses are not available from outside of the host. This is a private network, similar to what you do with virtualization or whatever. The Docker service sets up IP tables masquerading so the container can get out to the outside of the internet. You can also do some cool stuff to allow traffic back in. But in this example, what I do is I've got a Docker instance running. I've got a container running. And I use Docker inspect, and I pass some arguments to it, dash dash format with network settings IP address. And it comes back, and it says, oh, the address inside of here is 172.17.0.7. And that's great. That's good, because it has to have some sort of networking stack to be able to get out. But if I run IP show address on the Ethernet interface on this laptop, it's not even connected. It doesn't have an address. So this is just the way to isolate and to virtualize, although it's not virtualization in the traditional sense, but to give the Docker container its own IP address, and then you're going to use IP tables rules to do magic to let it in and out.
Yes. Is it using bridging underneath, or mm-hmm. So you have to have the bridge utilities installed?
Yep. Yeah, if you do VR control show on this, you'll see the Docker bridge. Yes, ma'am?
And should their namespaces be named the same
case as I'm sorry? The question is, can you see the namespaces? If you do it on a host, yes. Yeah. Sorry, I didn't understand the question at first, but yes, absolutely. You should be able to do IPNS show. It'll show those namespaces. In fact, if I just do an IPA show, it won't show the Docker, but it will show the Docker bridge. All right, IEC namespaces, inter-process communications namespaces. Same thing with inter-process communications. If I do a container and fire up, it's got no IPCs mapped, but the host has many. I do IPCS, show the inter-process communication, and there's nothing inside of the container. But then if I do the same thing on a different terminal on my actual laptop, I do IPCS, and there's page after page after page. So there's tons of stuff. So again, this is just showing that the container is isolated, segregated, thinks it has its own playground, thinks that it's its own OS. UTS namespaces, Unix time sharing system namespaces. Let the container think it's a separate OS with its own host name, potentially its own domain name, and so on. So if I run the hostname command on my laptop, it comes back and it says, oh yeah, you're t540p.tz.redhat.com. But then if I go inside of the container and run hostname, it's going to give me some randomly generated string. So again, the container thinks it's its own instance of the operating system. It doesn't even know about the host that's running it. All right, so changing gears a little bit. We talked about kernel namespaces. Everybody cool with that? Makes sense? All right, let's talk about control groups. So control groups are an awesome technology for a number of reasons. Control groups provide a mechanism for aggregating and partitioning sets of tasks and all of their future children into hierarchical groups with specialized behavior. Basically, this allows you to manage at a very fine-grained level disk I.O., network I.O., memory usage, CPU usage, namespaces, all kinds of stuff. And in the case of containers, these resources are those that are assigned to that container. So even if a container is compromised and somebody does something crazy, or even if you just have badly written code and the container spins out of control and some... Every year when the college students come in, we get fork bomb attacks. Like, is there... Oh, look how creative I am! If I do a fork bomb... Very cute. But if something happens,
you did it too.
You can. Somebody in here did that. But if something goes wrong inside of a container, whether it's malicious or just poorly written code, kernel namespaces can say, "Hey, this each container is only going to get 5% of CPU or 5% of memory or whatever." You can set jails around it or set limits around it. But the cool thing about that is it actually has a benefit outside of security in that if I'm using kernel or if I'm using C groups, then I can say, all right, I'm going to carve my memory up into 1,000 units or whatever arbitrary number it is, right? And the cool thing about that is now when you're assigning containers into control groups or you're launching containers in control groups, you know that you can spin up exactly 999, you're gonna leave some for the OS. But do you see what I'm saying? You can actually do some really, really accurate forecasting and go, I know exactly how many containers I can have on this machine because I've carved it up into number of C groups or whatever. So when I look, for instance, now this is on my Red Hat based system, I do system control status Docker, and you can see every Docker instance has has control groups assigned to it automatically at startup. You don't have to do anything, it's already there. You can actually then go in retroactively and say, whoa, we're gonna calm this one down. And if you look at our commercial offering, which is OpenShift, it actually has control groups on a per container basis, and so it becomes even easier to manage. So you can actually navigate the sysfs cgroup sudo directory to find out what resources are allocated to your containers. There's like 8,000 plus entries in there, so I'm not going to dig into those. But you can get information about memory usage, CPU, block I/O, network I/O, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So if I go to sysfs cgroups and I do find dot pywc-l, giving a list of how many entries there are in there, there's like 8,500 of them. So it's incredibly granular. You can go nuts. So you can't have a discussion about container security without talking about securing the daemon that's running containerization. Okay? In this case, it's Docker, user bin Docker. It's responsible for managing the control groups, orchestrating the namespaces, and so on, so that those images can be run and secured. Because of the need to manage kernel functions, Docker runs it through privileges. Just be aware of this. Don't grant access to folks willy-nilly, whomever you want. You know, you got to have some trust there, right? Allow trusted users to run Docker. The Docker documentation recommends that you add users to the Docker group so they can run Docker commands. We actually disable that capability. We figure this is as much a system service as virtualization or any other application services. In Red Hat Enterprise Linux, for instance, you run it as root, and then it drops privileges. A couple of tips. If you're using the REST API to manage your hosts, make sure you keep that stuff up to date. Because Docker is a very, and this is not a slam, this is emerging technology. It is very rapidly moving, which means that it is potentially a target-rich environment because the bad guys are looking at the cool new kids they're playing with, and they're like, well, can I mess up their day? So we want to make sure that you keep that stuff up to date. Use SSL or TLS or whatever your favorite encryption channel is if you're going to use the REST API over HTTP. Please don't expose it except to secured networks or do it over VPNs. If you're going to be running stuff out on Amazon, cool, that's awesome. Please make sure that you're not leaving stuff exposed to a public network. Just saying. Libcap, the Linux kernel capabilities. We're changing gears here now. Libcap is pretty cool. In historical Unix and Linux systems, right, root is omnipotent. Root can do anything they want, and if you grant root access to an application or to a user, you're pretty much betting the farm that they know what's going on. They're not going to do something either malicious or just silly. So Linux capabilities, though, is a set of fine-grained controls which allow services or users with the root equivalents to be limited in their scope. You can also use libcap to actually grant privileges to unprivileged accounts. It's pretty cool stuff. So it allows non-root users to be granted extra privileges. A root user, for instance, can be given the ability to only bind to ports under 1024. You know, normally only a root user can do that, but you may say, well, you know, for this one class of user, I'm going to allow them to spin up applications that weren't buying port 80 or 443 or whatever. In containers, many of the capabilities to manage network and other services are not needed, right? Because we're handling networking at the daemon level or at the configuration level. So things like SSH services, cron, file system mounts, unmounts, and things like that, network management is not needed. So by default, Docker disallows a whole bunch of root capabilities, including the ability to modify logs, change networking, modify kernel memory, and the catch-all cap sys admin, which I'll talk a little bit more about. And I'm sorry, guys, this is an awful eye chart. I just took a screenshot of the Docker daemon, the default template for libcap, and basically it just shows a whole bunch of the networking services, the ones that I just talked about, basically. It talks about which services are filtered by libcap within the Docker daemon. Remember I talked earlier that through user namespaces, we're like, yeah, you're root. You've got ownership. Well, okay, not really. You can't change networking. You can't spin up an SSH daemon, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And that is a function of libcap, just going, yeah, you're root, except that we're going to put a filter here, and all of these things that root normally can do are going to be stopped at that filter, and you get everything that's left that goes through it. So that's what libcap does. All right, security enhanced Linux, SE Linux, one of my favorite topics. If you don't like SE Linux and you don't understand SE Linux, you think SE Linux is the hand of the devil on Linux, I get you. I feel you. One of my first big jobs was I was a systems architect on the Linux engineering team at Bank of America. Financial services. Very, very interested in security, as you can well imagine. This is around the time of the transition from Red Hat Enterprise Linux version 3 to Red Hat Enterprise Linux version 4. And I was the dude that was doing security work for the bank with Linux, and I was like, all right, SE Linux, this is security stuff. I'm gonna, and I spent about 6 weeks on that and went, you know what? Disable that bad boy. Because at the time, documentation wasn't good, the tooling around it wasn't good, it was hard to understand, it was kind of wonky, and it wasn't easy to remediate when there were problems. Okay, that was a very freaking long time ago. SE Linux is easy enough to use that a Windows admin can do it. If you don't believe me, go to YouTube and look at SE Linux for Mere Mortals. It's a presentation I did at Red Hat Summit. It's about 45 or 50 minutes. It's SE Linux for Mere Mortals, the 2012 version, has been around and is one of the most heavily viewed. Or just go to stopdisablingselinux.com. And there's a link there to SE Linux for Mere Mortals. So go learn about it. Seriously, spend about 45 or 50 minutes of your time. It should change your outlook upon SE Linux. SE Linux is a mandatory access control system. Everything, processes, files, memory, network interfaces, and so on, have a label, and there is a policy which is administratively set and fixed. And that policy determines how all of these things, processes can interact with files, how processes can interact with each other, how processes can bind to or not bind to network ports, ports, memory addresses, all kinds of stuff like that. It's actually fairly straightforward. SE Linux is primarily concerned with labeling and type enforcement. So if I have a mythical service called the foo service, the executable file on disk might have the label foo exec type, because it's all about type enforcement. The startup scripts may have foo config type. The log files may have foo log type. These are all just labels. They're stored as extended attributes on the file system, you know, ext4 or xfs or whatever. The data for foo might have the label foo data type. And when the foo process is running in memory, the process may have the label foo underscore t, the foo type process running in memory. Type enforcement is just a set of rules that says something with this label is or is not allowed to interact with something with another label, whether it's a file, another process, a memory address, a port on the network, blah, 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 right? So if you think about it, a process running in the foo t context tries to access a file in the file system with a label foo config t or foo data t. Well, that probably makes sense, right? When you build the SE Linux policy, or actually hopefully when the application developer builds the SE Linux policy, that access is going to allow. But when the process with, when the process with the label foo t tries to write to a log file with foo log t, well, that makes sense as well. If the process running with foo underscore t in memory tries to access a file that has the label shadow underscore t, raise your hand if you think that's a good idea. Probably not. We don't want a daemon, a network-facing daemon, to be able to access the shadow file, right? That's all SE Linux is. You now understand SE Linux. It's just labeling and type enforcement. And it also does some things which some people will find actually irritating. I totally understand that. If the foo process is running something under /home/tcameron that has the SE Linux label /user/home/dir type, it's not going to be allowed. Even if I chmod 777, my home directory, SE Linux is going to go, no, not allowed. And SE Linux, as I said, are extended file, extended attributes on the file system or in memory. I'm going to move through how they're labeled, but essentially, really, the only thing you need to know about is you've got the SE Linux user, the SE Linux role, the SE Linux type, and then multi-layer, multi-category security afterwards. The only thing we really care about is the type, that SE Linux type, that's that third field over. And one thing that's just an interesting side fact is the default SE Linux policy for RHEL and for CentOS and for Fedora is the targeted policy. And a targeted policy, we literally have SE Linux policies for targeted services and binaries. And it's incredibly granular. It's, you know, stuff like Firefox has an SE Linux policy, the Apache web server and Nginx have policies and so on and so forth. Now, the thing that we really care about when we talk about the labels is you need to understand that these two down at the end are very different labels. Even though they're both user U, object role, foo type, when you go down into the MLS and MCS categories, S0C0 is completely different from S0C1. Those are totally different labels according to SE Linux. If they are not an exact match, they are it's a failure. And so, basically, what type enforcement says is that a process with the first label is different from a process with the second, so the process, the policy would prevent them from interacting, okay? And so, on a standalone system running Docker, all of the containers run in the same context, but for instance, again, in OpenShift, that's not the case. Each independent process is going to run with, you see down at the very end, it's C0, C1, C2, C3, C4, C5. So those are running in what to SE Linux is totally, totally different contexts. And so they will, even if a bad guy compromises one of the containers and goes, aha, I'm going to go attack the container that's next door, SE Linux is going to stop them. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you, I'm going to emulate an exploit, okay? Someone's going to take over a container, I'm going to use runcon, which is run in the context of blah, 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 to set my context to that of an OpenShift container. And then I'm going to try to access like Etsy Shadow and things like that. So here's the example. I'm logged in, I run ID, and you see that it's UID 0, I'm logged in as root, okay? If I do ID dash capital Z, you'll see that my context down at the end is S0 through S0, C0 through C1023. In other words, as root, I have access to all SE Linux contexts. So then what I'm going to do is I'm going to run con, and I'm going to change my user and my role. Actually, the only thing I'm really, really changing is my type is OpenShift type, and I'm going to give myself a fairly restrictive MLS and NCS category, S0 and C0 and C1. And you'll notice that as soon as I run the runcon command, it says, hey, you are no longer allowed to access bashrc in root's home directory. Guess why? Because it has the label root home dir type. Okay? Oh, well, I'm still root because I've got the hash, you know, I've got the hash mark for my prompt. I'm going to cat etsy shadow. Permission denied. I'm going to create a file in the root of the file system called test file. Can't touch it. Permission denied. I'm going to look in /home/tcameron. Again, permission denied because I am no longer in the right SE Linux context to be able to do this. Right now, because I changed to my SE Linux type to OpenShift type, OpenShift does not have access to home directories and things like that. So it's going to fail. Well, that's okay. I'm root. So I'm going to run set enforce 0 and turn SE Linux off. Not allowed because I'm no longer in the right context. Even though I am still root because I changed context, this is a great example of how SE Linux can save your bacon in the event of an exploit. And guys, I've lived through it. I have the scars. I was literally presenting at Texas Linux Fest 2013, I think. All of a sudden, my phone starts buzzing in my pocket. Bzz, bzz, bzz. I get text messages from a guy that I help with his IT stuff. He's an old friend of mine, you know, and I always help him set stuff up. And he's like, hey, dude, I'm getting these really weird pop-ups on the console of my Linux server. It's like all these, you know, ABC denial messages. Long story short, I had screwed up. I had made an error in the php.ini file. Okay? And all of a sudden, the bad guy sees, oh, PHP is misconfigured. He's just hammering on the machine. He's trying to get wherever he can. He had gotten in the context of the web server. And the web server has a lot of tendrils through a lot of areas in the file system. But he couldn't get to anything that was mission critical, and it didn't necessitate us burning the whole system down and starting from scratch, because I could go and look at log files and see all the things that he had tried to do, and he was not allowed to. So SE Linux is a really, really cool thing. I know a lot of folks hate it. It's really good. What time is it? Is there a GUI for it? There is. Go watch SE Linux for Mirror Models, and I'll show you how to set that up. Yeah. How are we doing on time? Okay, cool. All right, so let's talk about some tips and tricks. So did that make sense? All of these different things we're talking about, namespaces and C groups and SE Linux, that makes sense to everyone? Silence is assent. All right, cool. All right, tips and tricks. So what to do and what not to do. Containers are, at the end of the day, just processes running on the host. You got to use the same kind of common sense for SE Linux, containers, as you do for anything else you're running on the system, right? So, some do's. Have a process in place to update your containers and follow it. I have had entirely too many conversations with shops that are like, oh, containers are awesome. My developer built this thing for me 7 months ago, and I just keep spinning up new versions of it. Wait, what? 7 months ago. What framework are you using inside of it? PHP! So that's not a dig on PHP, it's just a fact of life that when you're using open source technology, it's moving really, really fast, and the bad guys are working really, really hard to find exploits. So have a process in place to update your containers and follow it. There are a ton of orchestration tools out there, there are a ton of update tools out there, Red Hat Satellite, that can help you with that. Run services in the containers with the lowest privilege possible and drop root privileges as soon as you can. That's kind of common sense, right? When you're running some of these network facing or potential bad guy get into, don't give them any authority when they do. Mount file systems with the host read only wherever possible. Okay? Treat root inside the container just like you would on the host. Even though libcap is there, they still have the ability to do stupid things, at least in their little pet playground, which is the container. So be careful. And watch your log files, folks. Keep an eye on things. If you see suspicious activity, act on it. Don't.
Well, I found Bill and Ted's excellent container repository. I think I'm going to download it and run it in my enterprise.
Get your CV up to date. Start sending out resumes. You're going to have a bad day. Don't run SSH inside the container. That just opens up a whole can of worms. Manage your container through the tools for generating and distributing containers. Don't SSH into it and run Yum update or whatever. Don't run with root privileges. Drop privileges wherever possible. Like I said, on Red Hat-based distros, we actually require that the daemon runs as root, but everything that you run after that gets drop privileges. Don't disable SE Linux. If you hate SE Linux, go watch SE Linux from Rare Mortals. Don't roll your own containers once and never maintain them. Notice I'm being a little redundant there. Seriously, guys, I see it all the time. Yeah, we got a container we spun up 7 months ago. Ooh, it hurts to hear that. Don't run production containers on unsupported platforms. If you are not a total container ninja, and, there aren't very many of those. Seriously, get something that can help you. Obviously, I want it to be Red Hat. I don't care. Even if you're going with another vendor, whether it's directly to Docker or with Canonical or whatever, if you're doing this white box, spun up myself, Frankenstein's monster of a distro, and you're doing container stuff on it, and you're the guru and you leave, you have just screwed your former employer. They are dead without, that one single one failure. So, in conclusion, containers are awesome. I love containers. They make app development and deployment really, really easy. They leverage some incredible capabilities of the Linux kernel. And the Linux kernel is very mature and very stable and has been around for a very long time. By design, they are relatively secure. I mean, look at all the things we've got layered in security, right? It's an onion, right? There's all kinds of cool stuff. But there are, as we mentioned, some gotchas. As with every other piece of software out there, right? This container technology requires some feeding and maintenance. Well-maintained containers can make your business more agile, less complex, and generally very, very safe. So I hope that you guys, if you're just dipping your toe in the pool, I hope that this has convinced you. The Docker containers are really cool. There's a lot of new stuff out there. I hope that you will go forth and contain them. Thank you very much. Do we have any questions? Yes, sir.
If you're running SE Linux on the host, are you automatically running it in the container?
So, yes, because it is isolated and protected by SE Linux. But if you, if you spin up an Ubuntu container, for instance, on a Fedora host, if you run get enforce inside of it, I think you're going to get a zero in there. So, in other words, it's protected by SE Linux because it's enveloped by SE Linux, but if you run, a version of a container that doesn't have SE Linux capabilities, then it's going to show you, no, there's nothing here. That makes sense?
Yes.
Yes.
What about host OSs? There's Rancher, there's CoreOS, there's Docker's thing. Of course, is there a strip Atomic? Is that the Red Hat answer to those?
Yes, yes. Project Atomic is the upstream project that we are now pulling technologies out of that go into OpenShift and other Red Hat internal products. But yeah, so Atomic is really cool. It allows for Atomic updates, so you can do things like say, oh, okay, I'm going to update the whole thing, and oh crap, that didn't work, and roll it back. And it has SE Linux enabled, it has blah, 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 blah. And there's a bunch of them out there, right? I mean, what you really have to do is you have to look at the vendor and make the decision, do I want to bet my enterprise on this vendor? Yes, sir.
What patterns are you seeing emerge for operational monitoring and management of stuff running in containers, or are there any?
I'm not going to say that I'm seeing patterns yet. As much as I'd love to say, well, yes, of course, naturally, everyone is using OpenShift and they're using all of our... Man, there's a ton of players out there, and they're good. I'm not going to stand up here and say, oh, they all suck and you should use mine, because there's some really badass stuff going on out there right now. I'm seeing everything. I'm seeing Puppet, I'm seeing Chef, I'm seeing Ansible, I'm seeing scripts with 4i and host 1, host 2, host 3. I mean, I'm seeing literally everything out there. We bought Ansible because Ansible does it really, really well. But we use Puppet because Puppet did it really, really well. So, you know, I know, it's like, even at Red Hat, we've got multiple personality disorder.
It's called an embarrassment of riches.
Yeah,
and
no those, kidding.
And all horrible certs, that was my grip with Puppet.
I'm sorry?
I don't manage all the damn certs.
I know, man, I wish, and we're trying like hell to get one. I wish that there was the big red button, right? My network is perfect now. it's not there yet. There's too many moving parts. We're doing a ridiculous amount of work on orchestration, on security. A guy, and I'm so proud of this, I hired a guy named Scott McCarty years ago. He is now our principal technical, and this sounds terrible, technical marketing manager. He's not a marketing guy. He's a Red Hat certified architect. He's a technologist. He's like the dude inside of Red Hat now around containerization and security. I'm like, I have a little piece to do with that. I heard it. And he's freaking brilliant. And he's got a lot of resources. And the teams that are doing work around containerization, we're doing a ton of work to secure and orchestrate and do stuff like that. We're doing registries in satellite so that you can bring that stuff behind the firewall and do your own registry for your internal private stuff. You can integrate that into your DevOps model so that you're doing CI/CD and you're kicking that stuff out. Scott even has this thing that he wrote, and he did a bunch of Python code around, but I'm just like, yep, too much for me. But he actually has a thing where he's got a CI/CD chain for the OS, a CI/CD chain for the containers. They then merge together to become a chain, and then it gets published to the registry on the satellite server and kicks off automatic deployments to update. And it only does respins of those layers of the container, whether it's the OS layer, the library layer, the application framework, or the actual content of the application. So we're doing a ton of stuff. We're trying to get that productized. We're trying to get it out there. We ain't the only players out there. We're trying to do, we're trying to be first to market and blah, 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 but a lot of competition, which is great for you. What else?
CI/CD.
Sorry, continuous integration, continuous deployment. It's a DevOps term for, I publish something, I do a git push, and it kicks off an automated process with Jenkins or, Cucumber for testing or something. Yes, sir.
I don't know if it relates to security, but I've heard Docker performance can be pretty awful from a network perspective because you're doing all that IP tables crap.
It can be.
Have they improved it?
We have.
What do you guys do?
We write really tight, really solid code, and we do just-in-time network bridging. We bring stuff up and take it down when it's
not close to wire speed yet?
What's that?
Has Red Hat gotten close to wire speed?
Totally depends on the use case. It totally depends on the density. I mean, I would love to be able to say, yes, all the time, anywhere. You can have 10 million containers on, a 486, and it's going to be awesome. It depends on a whole lot of factors. We're doing really, really well. We're using this technology, like I said, in our PaaS offering, OpenShift. And like I said, we're spinning up thousands of applications per VM, and we're getting performance out of it that our customers are paying for. So I take that as a yes. All right, so I got to ask you guys, was this helpful?
Yes.
Okay, good. Thank you very much for coming. I appreciate it. I'm sorry?
Are the slides available somewhere?
Yes, the slides. Just Google Thomas or send me an email, thomas@redhat.com, and I'll also make these available to the self 2016 folks so they can post it there. All right, cool. Yeah.
Where are you located physically?
Right here.
No, I mean,
I live in Austin, Texas, but my
Woo-hoo!
Role. Yeah, well, no. but my role is global, so I'm usually at about 33,000 feet. All right, cool. Get out of here. Thanks.
When we were trying to name Google, we actually went through thousands of names.
The name of the company has now become its own verb in the dictionary.
Let's Google it.
You can Google it.
Work the Google on the internet machine.
Six simple letters on a plain white page.
Being able to do searches in any language about any country.
When you're putting in a question, they'd finish your question for you.
We have been working on organizing the world's information.
Our goal is to digitize all the books.
Today, Google announced Gmail. Email for everyone for free.
Google is mapping the entire world to make it more accessible to people everywhere.
Google is jumping into the mobile market.
Android was built as an open platform for everyone to use and build on.
This is Chrome. It's a faster, safer browser for the open web.
Google is unveiling what they call the knowledge graph.
We needed to understand the world the way you and I do, as objects and relationships between objects.
Today, Google's got another useful feature with Google Now.
We are providing you with answers before you've even asked for
them.
One
of my favorite cards is the one that shows traffic data for your commute to and from work.
Think about how far Google has evolved from the 10 blue links.
We asked ourselves, how can we assist you right when you need it?
Okay, Google, call the Walker Arts Center.
It's not just desktops, phones, and laptops anymore.
Okay, Google. 유진이한테 5분 늦는다고 문자 보내줘.
It's watches with displays, car consoles with displays.
Okay, Google, let's go to the aquarium.
How can we help you get things done in as few steps as possible?
Okay, Google.
Okay, Google.
Okay, Google. Show me my photos of Lucas with the pumpkin.
But we have to remember, we have a long way to go.
This is just the tip of the iceberg.
before the second show.